Hello everybody and welcome back to our live coverage from the Bournemouth Air Festival, the last of our four live broadcasts over the course of Friday and Saturday. And we're very glad that you have joined us. We're very glad that it seems to have all gone so well. We didn't intend to stream at all yesterday, that was purely a test, but it was going so well from our end that we decided to share it with you, and then you seem to enjoy it, so we've just kept going. This is not a normal Plains TV live broadcast. Normally we have two or three or even more cameras, just the one today, and there's no fancy vision mixing going on, no graphics, no music, nothing like that. We literally have a camera with a microphone plugged into it that I'm talking into, and that is going straight out onto YouTube. I keep saying we. Who are we? If you're Plains TV regulars, you'll be used to seeing and hearing Ian. Well, Ian is not available to join us today, but we have Adrian on camera, just getting set up for the start of the night shows there, choosing which ND filter to start with. Adrian's been on camera for all of the past couple of days, getting used to some new equipment that we are not that familiar with, but using with increasing confidence. And that's one of the reasons why the last couple of days have been so valuable for us. We have a big few weeks coming up, lots of very important shows, and I'll talk about those in a moment. And then my name is Adam, I am normally a camera operator as well, but I'm talking you through the action today. I'm not an airshow commentator by any stretch of the imagination, but we cannot connect to the main PA system here because we are up on the top of the Cumberland Hotel, enjoying an absolutely fantastic view, five stories up and on top of the cliffs as well, so probably a couple of hundred feet above the height of the water and getting an eye level view of the flying displays. We're very grateful to the Cumberland for hosting us. It's a terrific viewpoint up here. Now, I mentioned streams coming up over the next couple of weeks. I'm sure I'll mention these a few times over the course of the broadcast, so apologies if you're joining us for the full hour and a half, 2 hours or so. You will hear me mention this a few times, but on Thursday we are live on YouTube, another free broadcast, but that'll be the real deal with multiple cameras, a proper commentary, and that will be from the Jersey Air Display. Then next week we are live on watch.plainstv.com, which is our own streaming service. Head over to the website, you can see how to subscribe to that. And we are live broadcasting from the Duxford Battle of Britain Air Show, probably the world's premier warbird air show this year, more than 20 Spitfires among various other types. And then we are assisting with a live broadcast from the NATO days and Czech Air Force days 1 week after that. Can't tell you yet exactly how to access that stream, but I'm sure if you subscribe to the Plains TV newsletter on our website, Ian will let you know. It probably won't be through our YouTube channel or streaming service. That will be, I would imagine, through NATO Day's website or social media pages. But that all to be confirmed. But that is all in the future, and let's talk a little bit about what we're expecting to see over the course of this evening. The flying display due to start at 19:24. That's in 9 minutes from now. It will start with a Spitfire PR-19. Of the Rolls-Royce Heritage flight. Now, for those of you who joined us earlier, you will have seen the Battle of Britain Memorial flight, and I mentioned during that display that we would have a second sort of BVMF Spitfire over the course of the day. That's the Rolls-Royce Heritage flight example, which was one of the founding members of the BVMF back in the 1950s when it was founded. And now in civilian hands, of course. Then after that, something which proved absolutely stunning yesterday, Anarchy 1, the Typhoon FGR-4, the Royal Air Force sunset performance. Again, those of you who joined us earlier today will have already seen the Typhoon performing its normal daytime show, and also the synchro pair combination display with the Spitfire Mark II of the Battle of Britain Memorial flight. This is just the solo Typhoon, but hopefully in absolutely stunning conditions with the afterburners of those two EJ2000 engines standing out well against the darkening sky. Then, following that, we have a trio of pyro acts. will start at around about 8 o'clock. The first of them, the Firebirds, with two RV4s, fireworks streaming from the Wintix. Then we have Otto the helicopter, flown by Brendan O'Brien, at 10 past 8, carrying more pyrotechnics than any other aircraft on Earth. A skygasm, they call it, because of the explosive effect. And finally, closing the show, we have the Tigers parachute display team from the British Army. We'll do our best to pick them out in the dark. It is difficult because it will be getting really quite black in the sky by then, and they don't have any lights on them initially. However, once they are under their canopies, some of the jumpers will have pyrotechnics on their ankles. That'll help us pick them out. And the evening's entertainment will be wrapping up a little after 8:30. So I do hope you'll stick with us until the end. A relatively short flying display program, but nonetheless a very enjoyable one. I think what I'm going to do now is fire up the chat, see if anyone has joined us yet. I have been trying to keep an eye on the chat over the course of the day, and give a personal thank you to anyone who's been kind enough to do a super chat or become a channel member, which we do really appreciate. Obviously, I've mostly been looking either up in the sky or down at my notes. Yes. Fast as Funk says, Brendan O'Brien basically in a flying bomb then. Yes, 2,500 pyrotechnic shots he can put on that aircraft. I think for a typical display it's more in the region of 2,000, but that is still more than enough, shall we say. Mr. Dragonfire says, curious, the audio is split, the commentator seems to be on the right channel only. Yes, well, this is an experimental one-camera setup that's not going through any processing software or anything like that. We've got two microphones. One is the atmosphere mic, picking up the sound of the displays, and that is on one channel, and I'm talking into the other channel. It's the only way we can do it, I'm afraid, with this one-camera thing. As I said earlier, this is not ideally how we would run a stream, and what you see from Jersey when you tune in on Thursday, if you tune in on Thursday, will be a whole different league. But a bare-bones stream today, touch and go as to whether we did anything at all this weekend. It wasn't originally on our plans, but as I said, we decided to come down, test out some equipment before a busy few weeks. We can't spare the time or the equipment to do anything more substantial than this, and one of the reasons Ian isn't with us today is because he is down in Devon at Planes TV HQ, working hard on preparing for those important commitments over the coming weeks. Thanks, host guy, your name. My name is Adam. And I'm normally a camera operator. You don't hear or see me, and it is much better that way, I think. But just because we haven't got a link to the commentary system today, I thought I'd come along, enjoy the show, and talk you through it a little bit. On camera is Adrian, who Planes TV regulars will have, if not seen, then at the very least heard about many times through the years. Founded Planes TV more than 30 years ago, and much of that archive from the past 30 years is available on our streaming service at watch.planestv.com. So if you've enjoyed what you have seen today, then do head over there, consider subscribing. And if you don't want to do that, then perhaps become a supporter of our YouTube channel. Every little helps. And that does encourage us to come and do more free stuff out on YouTube, as well as the big shows that generally go out on the streaming service, the likes of the Air Tattoo, which we broadcast live. We actually broadcast the Air Tattoo live over 6 days. Arrivals and departures free to view on YouTube, partly as we got settled into the equipment and got to learn the display sequences ourselves, and then the real deal on the streaming service watch.planestv.com, exclusively for our subscribers there. But plenty of shows through the year that go out free on YouTube as well, and this year there have been a number of Duxford flying days that have gone out for free. The old Buckingham Air Show, the first day of the Battle of Britain Air Show at Headcorn. Possibly one or two others that I'm forgetting about. Meanwhile, on the streaming service, the Duxford Summer Air Show, the second 2 days of the Battle of Britain Air Show at Headcorn, the upcoming Duxford Battle of Britain Air Show, and the Air Tattoo, as I have mentioned. So it is definitely worth subscribing to the streaming service if you can, because you do get an awful lot of our best content through the streaming service. Oh, some very kind comments about my commentary. Seriously, I have enjoyed it, but I enjoy being behind the camera as well. We were discussing earlier whether I can do both at the same time. It would be a bit of a push. I don't think I could do both well, that's for certain. Emma says, typhoon yesterday evening, OMG, burner on it. Yeah, it stood out so well, didn't it? And I'm sure we'll see the same today. If anything, it'll be darker today because we don't have the benefit of the sun. So we did enjoy yesterday the Spitfire PR19 glinting very nicely in that late evening light as the sun moved over our shoulder. It is obscured by cloud today, so the Spitfire might not look quite as exciting, but then when we get on to the pyro shows, it'll be a darker sky. And here comes the first of today's participants. Spitfire PR19 of the Rolls-Royce Heritage Flight, an aircraft that shouldn't really exist, because a Spitfire is not what the Royal Air Force ordered. They ordered 200 Supermarine Spitefuls, the Spitfire's planned successor, but when that project was cancelled, 79 Mark 19 Spitfires were delivered instead. This is one of them, delivered to the Central Photographic Reconnaissance Unit at Benson in January 1945. She served in mainland Europe until the war ended, and then returned to Britain, was selected for conversion from a photo reconnaissance platform to a meteorological research aircraft. As a Met research aeroplane, she served with the Short Brothers meteorological research flight between 1950 and 1957, and then returned to the Royal Air Force as one of the three founding Spitfires of the unit that would become the Battle of Britain Memorial Flight. Over the decade that followed, she shuffled between the BBMF, various other RAF stations, ended up briefly as a gate guardian at West Raynham before being restored, ended up back with the BBMF in 1964. The aircraft was then sold onto the civilian market in 1995. Became part of the Rolls-Royce Heritage Flight 1 year later, still with them today, based at East Midlands Airport, flown today by Chris Hadlow, who was their regular Spitfire pilot, been very active on the airshow circuit over the past couple of years. Let you enjoy the rest of the display in silence, save for the sound of the Rolls-Royce Griffin that powers this magnificent machine. Well, we very much enjoyed that. I hope you did. Thank you for joining us here on Plains TV. If you have just joined us over the last few minutes, that was the first display of the night air portion of the Bournemouth Air Festival Day 3 and our last live broadcast of the show. I can see out to our right the next display but one is holding the Firebirds with their two RB4s, but we're looking out for the Royal Air Force Typhoon FGR4 next, which will be arriving, I suspect, from our left in a few minutes' time. I saw a message in the chat which I've been keeping half an eye on, and I wish I could remember who said it, saying the Merlin is absolutely lyrical, but the Griffin sounds like it wants an actual fight. Yes, I get what you're saying there. I'm inclined to agree. And we've just heard why the Firebirds are up in the hold already. I thought it was rather early, but they are joining up with the Spitfire PR19 for a formation flypast. And we'll be seeing the full Firebirds display later on. This isn't purely frivolous, by the way. There is a link between Warbirds and the Firebirds. John Dodd, one of the Firebirds' pilot, is a Warbird pilot as well. And of course, the founders of the Firebirds, back when it was called the Fireflies, have left the team in order to fly Warbirds full time. Well, this was a lovely surprise addition to the schedule, and we're looking out for it now, due to arrive from the right very shortly. Well, wasn't that a nice surprise addition to the flying programme? The Fireflies will now separate and return to the hold. They'll be displaying for us again in 15 minutes or so. But first, we've got something very, very noisy indeed. An aircraft that entered service in 2003, became fully operational in 2006. It is, of course, the Eurofighter Typhoon FGR-4. Started out as a Typhoon F2. FGR-4 has its capabilities increased through a series of upgrades through the years. And upgrades very much still ongoing. A contract currently being tendered to add new radar and also an overhaul of the cockpits, adding multifunction displays, or rather replacing the multifunction displays with F-35 style large area displays to improve the pilot's situational awareness. Very much an international project as well. Of course, the various partner nations continue to order the Typhoon, Germany and Spain having placed substantial orders only recently. But also exports continuing, particularly to the Middle East. And those who followed our live coverage of the Royal International Air Tattoo will have seen a couple of particularly interesting Typhoons arriving to take their place in the static display. We had a joint British-Qatari operated Typhoon, And we also had a Kuwaiti example from their operational conversion unit that was actually in the process of being delivered. Of course, that is all available to view across our YouTube channel and on our streaming service, watch.planestv.com, where you can also find our back catalogue of 30 years of programmes, as well as enjoying some of our upcoming broadcasts, such as the Duxford Battle of Britain Air Show next week, which will be broadcast exclusively at watch.planestv.com. Now, we'll look out to the left for the typhoon. Adrian spotted it pretty early yesterday. Adrian's on camera, if you missed me explaining that earlier on. He spotted the strobe light standing out rather brightly, and I sort of caught up with him sometime later. In fact, yes, there is that strobe flashing away. I can see Adrian zooming in on something. Have you caught it? Yes, you have. Terrific. Well, it's about to get very noisy indeed. The sound of two Eurojet EJ2000 engines about to light up the sky as the aircraft runs in at 600 knots for its first pass. Enjoy this. This is going to be quite special. Each year's Typhoon display pilot constructs their own display routine from a series of pre-approved manoeuvres. They can choose which order to display those manoeuvres in, which ones to include in their routine. This year, it's Flight Lieutenant Adam O'Hare starting his display with a roll on the right 45 degree line. Repositioning the aircraft, turning onto the B-axis, taking full advantage of the Typhoon's 23 degree per second turn rate, and now pitching up for an aileron roll and then pulling up. Typhoon is a 10G aeroplane. Now, I've experienced 4.5G and that was quite enough for me, but 10G and sustained as well, being achieved regularly throughout this display. Not just the amount of G that's impressive, it's also the G onset rate of 10 G per second, faster than can be replicated in a centrifuge. But now negative G, minus 3 G during this push, fuel venting from the tail. And that is perhaps even more unpleasant. The blood rushes to your head, it makes your eyeballs feel enormous. And of course, a G-suit cannot counter it. But now, running in for 3.5 aileron rolls, it's going to show off the Typhoon's roll rate of 250 degrees per second, one of the fastest roll rates of any frontline fighter. See the aircraft flying pretty much as fast as it's legally allowed to at an airshow in the UK. A fast pass and then braking into a very aggressive barrel roll, decelerating rapidly as it does so. Impressive transition from high speed to low speed flight, 600 knots on that pass and decelerating very rapidly for a slow pass, unusually being performed on the B axis towards us, one of the changes enacted for this year's display as compared to last year's, makes the aircraft look like it's going even slower than it really is and really shows off the angle of attack that the aircraft is sustaining, limited to 24 degrees of alpha by the flight control software. And the aircraft will then break off to our left and engage the afterburners as it does so. This aircraft was painted black for aggressor duties a few years ago, and then when a dedicated display aircraft was needed for the 2021 and 2022 display season, they applied some Union Jack decals to that design, and the result is known as Blackjack. Accelerating again in order for the landing gear to come down, we'll see a dirty roll on the 45 degree line in towards us. The landing lights will be switched on, pointing straight towards us. This has always been one of the specialities of Typhoon displays from the Royal Air Force through the years, spending as much time as possible pointing the nose directly towards the crowd. You can see the afterburner standing out there very nicely as well. Accelerating out of that very slow manoeuvre, leveraging the enormous amount of power the Typhoon has available to accelerate back to around 600 knots for another fast pass. Of course, Typhoon can go much faster than this, but the legal limit in the UK is Mach 0.95. Demonstrate its 23 degree per second turn rate once again with a 360 degree high G turn, diving in for that now. The afterburner will be engaged as the aircraft turns away from us. And then round the back of the turn, the reheat is switched off. Because even in this 9G turn with reheat engaged, the aircraft would continue to accelerate and break the speed limit. Now, as the thrust buckets come back towards us, watch for the telltale puff of smoke as the afterburner is re-engaged. There it is, and the burner comes back on. Those engines not just being used for energy management, but also part of the impact of the display, the crew working out exactly when the optimum moments are to expose that to that power that the aircraft can generate. deciding when the reheat will have the biggest visual impact, trying to use it in those moments. Saw its combat debut in 2011, securing the no-fly zone over Libya as part of Operation Elmi, and it's been used almost continuously on operations in the Middle East over the last few years. Now, one final manoeuvre, pulling up into the vertical, aileron rolling as he does so. What a terrific display. Get ready for a change of pace though, because the next act will be the return of the Fireflies. If you are just joining us, I hope you enjoyed that Typhoon display. We most certainly did. You might be wondering why you're not getting the official show commentary. That's because we are up here on the roof of the Cumberland Hotel. They're very kindly hosting us. This is the place to be. There's been a pool party in the gap between the afternoon and the evening displays. Plenty of people taking out rooms here just to enjoy the show. And we're having the most fantastic vantage point from up here on the roof. But it does mean we can't plug into the official PA system. My name's Adam, I'm usually a camera operator, but instead I'm doing my best to talk you through the action. And Adrian working away on the camera. Always a very challenging display to film, that Typhoon, so I'm sure you'll agree you did a sterling job.
Yeah, you're working but you're enjoying it. It's weird, isn't it?
Yeah, I know what you mean. It's been fun all day.
It has. It's quite windy, so up here with a long lens on this rickety platform we built for ourselves to give us a bit of extra height for the aircraft over on the right. It's tricky, but I could live here.
And for those who don't know, you founded Planes TV. You've been doing this for about 30 years, and where can people see all of your stuff, or almost all of your stuff?
Yeah, almost all. That's interesting, that, because in 1992 we went into a much more expensive professional video system called M2. It was a broadcast system. But unfortunately, about 10 years ago, we were broken into and trashed by a protection racket who destroyed the M2 machines, which meant we couldn't get at our M2 tapes to capture them and show them. But would you believe, six weeks ago, we actually managed to get them repaired. Took a lot of finding someone who can do it, who's got the bits, but we've now got our M2 machines working again. So we're about to, we've started capturing stuff from 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, which we haven't been able to capture before. So there's a lot of really interesting stuff about to come onto the channel.
And a lot of that will likely be available on the Planes TV streaming service, watch.planestv.com, where you can also find many existing programmes, and next week's live broadcast from the Duxford Battle of Britain Air Show will be available exclusively there. So if you've enjoyed what you've seen today, albeit today is a one-camera experimental stream, then you should certainly enjoy what's coming next week, which will be much more polished, multi-camera, and arguably the world's premier warbird air show of the year, coming to you live on our streaming service. We'll also be live from the Jersey Air Display this coming Thursday. That'll be a free-to-view stream on YouTube. So if you can't subscribe to the streaming service, make sure you are subscribed to us on YouTube. turn your notifications on so you get a little notification to your phone when we do go live. Better still, sign up to the email newsletter on our website. And Ian, who's not with us today, if you're a regular viewer, you'll be very familiar with Ian, but he's at home preparing for all these shows that are coming up. Ian sends out an email newsletter from time to time when we are about to do something. You'll get a bit more notice through that. Adrian says he sees some lights. Well, that'll be the fireflies. I can't see any lights. Where are you looking?
To the left of the green... that way.
Now Adrian's going to zoom in on some lights for us, which I can't see with the naked eye. Oh yes, I see them. That'll be the fireflies in their two RB4s, I would think. Indeed it is. Two Vans RV4 kit aeroplanes, home builds. It's an aircraft that first flew in 1974, the fourth most popular model in the Vans RV family of kit planes. You can build them in your garage from a set of plans and parts. You can also buy factory assisted builds or second hand aircraft that are obviously already completed. Very popular the world over, because as you'll see, it's a fun aircraft to fly, aerobatic, and yet also an ideal tourer with two seats, room for some bags, a 600 mile range, cruise speed of 200 miles per hour. Fly high enough to get above the worst of the weather as well. No pressurised cockpit, so you need to have an oxygen supply of some kind if you want to go above about 12,000 feet. And for maximum flexibility, you can use them with a variety of different types of engine. We're seeing that demonstrated today because one of these aircraft is fitted with a 150 horsepower version of the Lycoming 0320 with a two-bladed propeller. The other one with a 160 horsepower version of the same engine with a three-bladed propeller. So quite different performance between the two aircraft, which must make it quite difficult to manage and coordinate close formation aerobatics. And Neil, I see, has just joined us as a channel member. That's very much appreciated. Thank you, Neil. That sort of thing does encourage us to get out and do more of these free-to-view YouTube live streams, so yes, thank you very much indeed. Push the like button, says Sylv. Yes, again, same applies. That does encourage us. Sylv is also a new channel member. I remember joined earlier on today. Had quite a few new members. It's been a good day in that regard. Now the Fireflies are going to start with some conventional formation aerobatics, but they will be adding some fireworks to the display in around 5 minutes from now. But starting with a loop in line abreast, two aircraft flying one alongside the other, and over the course of the loop, the wingman will move rearwards into echelon formation, the standard two-ship formation with one aircraft slightly behind the other. The team was founded by Andy Durston and John Gowdy. I can't remember whether it was 2016 or 2017, but it was one of those 2 years. They've now left the team to focus on their Warbird exploits. And the displays nowadays are flown by Nigel Reed and John Dodd. To mark the new ownership this year, the team has changed their names from the Fireflies to the Firebirds. Why fire? Well, you'll see very soon. We've enjoyed watching their day show earlier today. It's not all about what the aircraft are doing in terms of aerobatic manoeuvres. It's also a case of watching the smoke trails, some sky art that goes on, very graceful patterns that they create in the sky. GB asks, are they allowed to put lights on the wings? The answer is, it's complicated. The moment you put things on the wings that could disrupt the airflow, that comes potentially problematic and also very difficult in terms of securing the permits required. Two aircraft have now departed out in front of us. They're going to turn around to run in on what we call the B axis. That's the line that comes straight in towards show centre, perpendicular to the crowd line. And this is where things are going to get interesting. Fireworks on the wingtips, ignited by E-matches with an electric current that is introduced at the press of a button from the cockpit. So the pilot will be calling fire, fire, fire. And here they go. So these waterfalls or gerbs, whichever one they are, starting to expire. Burn time of about 30 seconds on those. You might have seen some other fireworks at the very beginning when they pressed the fire button, some Roman candles, little coloured balls that were flying everywhere. They have a slightly shorter burn time of around 30 seconds. And there are, I believe, four firing solutions on these aircraft. In other words, they can fire pyrotechnics on four occasions. If they've got a burn time of 1 minute each, that's 4 minutes of pyro over the course of the entire show. We're about to see the next set of fireworks go off on this next pass, I believe. Don't underestimate the amount of work required to set this up, by the way, many hours before the show. Fitting fireworks to the aircraft, wiring them all up to those firing solutions so they can be detonated. And those are Roman candles like what I was referring to earlier. It takes a good few hours to set up all of that pyro, as I was describing. It's a job that I used to do for another team. I've done it with a couple of teams. And, don't underestimate how much hard work it is, not just before the show, but also cleaning up after the show. They will be on that airfield until late this evening. The spent pyro will have to be removed from the aircraft, all of the wiring undone, so this is not a quick job. When we all pack off home for the day and go to bed, there's an awful lot of work for all of the pilots and crews of these pyro display teams still to do. Massively worthy of our respect. I did see a message pop up in the chat not long ago, someone asking where the team are based for this display today. Virtually all of the air display assets that have been taking part in the Bournemouth Air Festival have been operating from Bournemouth Airport, a couple of miles behind us. If you watched the stream this afternoon, you'll have seen we managed to catch the Red Arrow's landing brake over the Bournemouth skyline at the end of the stream. Such a unique view up here from the roof of the Cumberland Hotel, where we can actually look down on the water and see the reflection of the pyro in the sea. Absolutely magical, and we are very grateful to them for allowing us to be here. Of course, you could be here too next year. They offer day rates during the air show. You could hire a room with a balcony overlooking the sea. That was the fourth and final of the bursts of firework that we see over the course of this display, and now the team will run in for a heart in the sky drawn with their smoke trails created by injecting an environmentally friendly oil very similar to baby oil into the hot exhaust, where it vaporizes, creating these smoke trails. Totally benign, you can have a bath in the stuff. So no environmental damage being done by this smoke. I think that's just about the best heart we've seen them do over the past couple of days. That was pretty much bang on. Now, normally that would be the end of their display, but they are going to give us one last flypast with those LED lights on the side of the fuselage standing out so well, flying down in trail from right to left to say farewell to us. Well, we're about to up the ante when it comes to fireworks, because I can see our next display item out to the left already. Landing light above the headland. And we're about to see the aircraft that carries more fireworks on board than any other in the world. 2,500 pyrotechnic shots, to be precise. This aircraft that we're about to see is a Schweitzer 300. Started out life in the United States on the airshow circuit there in the hands of Roger Buis, who modified the aircraft for a comedy show. Brendan O'Brien purchased it in 2016 and brought it to the UK. Now that is a name that you should be very familiar with if you know anything about airshows in Britain. He's one of the best known airshow pilots in the country. He's long entertained us with his various barnstorming acts, including truck top landings even, with a Piper Cub landing on the back of a moving trailer. He has 13,000 flight hours and over 300 aircraft types, from gliders to fast jets, hot air balloons, helicopters, float planes, microlights and more. He has flown on every continent on Earth, including Antarctica. He's presented TV shows including Spitfire Race and Flightline. He's a flight instructor, an adventurer, he commentates, performs at air shows. He also serves as one of Britain's foremost display authorisation examiners. Yesterday, we saw Alex Garman displaying Otto the helicopter. Formerly part of Brendan's ground crew, it was his first public display in Otto the helicopter. But today, it is Brendan O'Brien himself who shall be performing for us. A first pass with smoke system on and pyro starting to fire, just a limited amount of pyro on this first pass. Like the Firebirds, this is an act that has been through a bit of rebranding over the past few months. Formerly O'Brien's Flying Circus, now Pilots of the Purple Twilight, available not just for air shows, but also for weddings, parties, bar mitzvahs, even funerals. Firing ashes, but now firing pyrotechnics instead. Crackle Comet shooting out the front of the helicopter, my favourite of all of the pyrotechnics used by the night display teams. The tempo about to increase yet further. think the aircraft is on fire if it departs. Don't worry. That is merely a very, very powerful smoke system indeed, with a light shining back into it. It can look quite alarming at times, but all is well. Well, how about that? Absolutely terrific. If you haven't ever seen a night display in person, then do make it one of your priorities, because there is little that can compare. An absolutely magical thing to view. It's become an integral part of the British air show scene over the past few years. They've been occurring in the United States since the 1980s. First came to the UK in 2010. They really gained traction in 2012 when one took place during the Paralympics opening ceremony. And in the years that followed, the number of pyro-capable teams grew and grew. And this, the Bournemouth Air Festival, arguably the first British event to really dabble with large-scale nighttime air displays, still remains one of the largest of its kind. Absolutely fantastic. Well, we've got a short gap before the next flying display item, the final flying display item, in fact, which is the Tigers parachute display team from the British Army, which gives me a chance to welcome everybody who has joined us over the last 10 minutes or so and explain a little bit about who we are and what we're doing here today. We have Planes TV. We film air shows all around Europe, live streaming them where possible. Today is not quite the real deal in terms of a Planes TV live stream. This is just one camera with a microphone that I'm speaking into, and it's being beamed out onto YouTube. Normally we have multiple cameras. It's all being vision mixed. We're taking a feed directly from the public address system, so you hear the real show commentators rather than me. But this is sort of an experiment, trying out some new equipment, getting acquainted with it. I say new equipment, we've had it for about a month now, but still learning how to use it more competently and confidently. We didn't really have any solid plans to be here at Bournemouth at all until a couple of days ago. Came along yesterday as an opportunity to get practiced on some of this equipment, but it was all going so well that we decided to put it out onto YouTube for you to enjoy. And our viewing spot up here on the top of the Cumberland Hotel, you couldn't really ask for better. If you are enjoying it and you want to see the real deal, we'll be streaming again. It'll be a proper stream next time, with multiple cameras and vision mixers and proper commentary. That'll be from the Jersey Air Display on Thursday, featuring such acts as the Red Arrows, the Chinook, a number of aircraft from France, including the Dassault Flamand, the Corsair, and the OV-10B Bronco. Then next weekend we are live broadcasting the Battle of Britain air show from Duxford, probably the finest warbird air show in the world this year. More than 20 Spitfires, 5 Hurricanes, and many, many other historical aircraft, plus the MilMi 24 from the Czech Air Force making its final UK air display appearance ahead of its retirement before the next display season. If you want to watch that, that will be in our streaming service, watch.planestv.com, exclusively available to our subscribers there. If you're tuning in and you're a regular Planes TV viewer, one question you might have is, where is Ian, and who on earth is this that is speaking? I don't recognise this voice. Well, Ian is not available to join us today. He's down at Planes TV HQ in Devon, getting ready for the very busy couple of weeks that we've got. Jersey, Duxford, and then the week after that, NATO days in the Czech Republic. So, not available to join us today. But Adrian is on camera doing a fantastic job. I've been looking through the chat from time to time and seeing some very favourable comments about Adrian's camera work. He's doing a great job in not the easiest conditions. It being a one-camera shoot, it's quite windy up here as well. Standing on an improvised platform to get a bit of extra height. It's not conducive to excellent camera work, but everybody seems to be enjoying it. And my name is Adam. I'm normally a camera operator as well, but seeing as we're not taking a feed from the real public address system, I've come along to talk you through the action. It's better than watching it in silence, isn't it? At least I hope it is. You might have been willing me to shut up all day, but I certainly hope not. We are looking out for the Tigers parachute display team jump ship, which is a Cessna 208 Caravan. It'll be making a low pass overhead us and then climbing to altitude to prepare for the parachute jump itself. It's going to be a bit of a challenge to capture this because, as you can see, it's getting very dark now, and as the parachutists leave the aircraft, we'll be filming small black things on an almost black sky. So we'll do our best. But once the parachutists have deployed their canopies, many of them will be igniting cold-burning pyrotechnics on their ankles. I say cold-burning, they're stage fireworks, if you like. You can put your hand through them, they're not going to burn you. But that's very important, because if you have conventional fireworks that get anywhere near a parachute canopy, it's going to burn and disintegrate. That's not a desirable situation to be in at all when you're at 2,000 feet. So cold-burning fireworks, so as not to damage the canopy, but enough to light them up nice and bright for Adrian to get a camera on them as they fall. We won't be able to capture the landings either, I'm afraid, because the beach is just out of sight. If you've ever been to Bournemouth, there's the beach, behind the beach there's some cliffs, and on top of the cliffs there's all of the hotels set back a little way. We're on top of one of the hotels, the Cumberland Hotel. We cannot quite see the beach drop zone. I can see little bits of sand and some groins stretching out into the sea, but not the drop zone itself, so they will just disappear behind the foliage in the final few seconds of their flight. Lord Supreme Akara asked a short while ago, what time is the Jersey Air Display stream on Thursday? Short answer is, we don't know yet for certain. We haven't seen a flying programme yet. We probably won't see one until we actually arrive in Jersey on Wednesday afternoon, perhaps not even then. But I've been to the Jersey Air Display a couple of times, and as far as I can remember, the flying typically starts at around about midday, 1 o'clock. We have an aircraft running in towards us now, which Adrian is shortly to get a camera on. I don't think you'll see much though in this light, but this is the Cessna 208 of the Tigers parachute display team, making a low pass overhead, checking that they can see the drop zone clearly, checking also what the wind is doing, deciding roughly from which point they will need to exit the aircraft. I don't envy Adrian here, because it's going to pass almost directly overhead, which is very difficult to track on a whacking great big tripod such as what we've got. Of course, it's absolutely vital, a whacking great big tripod, to film all of the long lens stuff. You can't do it without it. But there's only one weak point, and that is when something goes directly overhead, which is what is about to happen now.
Very closely on the left hand side of the aircraft, and you will see a big door coming.
dare say Adrian did a very good job of tracking that rather tricky pass there. We shall now see the aircraft climbing to altitude, having performed that low pass. Difficult to say how high they are going to climb, because in these lighting conditions it is impossible to judge how high the cloud is. I would say it looks fairly high. The highest the Tigers would go is 6,000 feet, because beyond that point you're not really going to see anything. So they'll start that climb now. If they are going to 6,000 feet, it'll probably take them about 5 minutes or so. Powered all the way on that climb by a Pratt & Whitney PT6A turboprop engine. Pretty much the standard engine for small turboprop aircraft, whether it's a Cessna Caravan or a King Air, a Twin Otter, or something with military purpose. The Pilatus PC-21, PC-7, PC-9, Beechcraft T6 Texan 2, all of the foreign equivalents almost, including the Hercus from Turkey, the Woombi from Korea, they all use the PT6. Gives the aircraft an awful lot of power, very good climb performance, 1,200 foot per minute climb rate. It's not bad for a single engine aircraft with a capacity for 14 people. And it's a highly suitable jump ship, not only because of that reasonably favourable climb rate, but also because it has a high wing and a very large door at the rear of the fuselage, which makes it very easy for the parachutists to exit the aircraft. While we wait, I'll tell you a little bit about the team. They were founded in 1986, originally under the name The Dragons, but now The Tigers, as we all know. They're one of four parachute display teams of the British Army, the others being the Red Devils, the Lightning Bolts, and the Silver Stars. They're composed of nine members of the Princess of Wales Royal Regiment. Now, when they jump today, we're going to see two groups of parachutists. The first group will be demonstrating free fall to us at 120 miles per hour, falling quite some distance before deploying their parachutes and then coming into land. Pyrotechnics on their feet, they'll be coming in individually, some quite sporty approaches often, lots of twisting and turning all the way down. And then we'll turn to the second group. Three parachutists we expect, demonstrating some close formation canopy flying. They'll actually be tethered together and they will dive down towards show centre almost vertically, a couple of hundred feet above the drop zone. They will dramatically separate and break into the landing pattern. Still a couple of minutes to go though, so I may as well take this moment to say thank you once again to everyone who has joined us today and over the past 2 days. We're so glad that the stream has been well received, this experimental stream using a method that I don't think we've ever used before, going straight from a camera onto YouTube. Maybe we have at some point in the dim and distant past, but certainly not from this camera specifically. It's been a bit of a learning experience for all of us, and anyone who joined yesterday afternoon, hopefully you're noticing it is a slightly smoother viewing experience today. If you are enjoying it, then we do hope you'll feel motivated to head over to watch.planestv.com and subscribe to our streaming service. where you'll get access to a large chunk of our back catalogue with more yet to be added. Also upcoming live streams, some of which will be going out exclusively on that streaming service. If you can't manage that, then we've had several new members of our YouTube channel today. That's a good way of supporting us and encouraging us to do more of these free streams. And at the very least, we'd appreciate it if you could drop a like on the video and maybe even subscribe. If you do subscribe, remember to turn on notifications. Well, the parachutists exiting the aircraft very shortly, standing in the door at the moment with those pyro burning, which makes it much easier for us to see. We see Adrian has got the camera on them, and the first parachutists have exited the aircraft. This is the group that will be demonstrating free fall to us, and good luck, Adrian, picking them up now, because they have completely disappeared. We will see them re-emerge shortly. They will deploy their parachutes and then ignite another round of pyrotechnics, cold burning, as I mentioned, so as not to damage the canopy. Just about make out some silhouettes with the naked eye. Whether or not you can see them on the screen is another matter. And there we go. That makes it much easier, doesn't it? Probably can't make it out in these lighting conditions, and to be honest, I wouldn't be able to tell either if I didn't already know, but one of them carrying the flag of TSA Consulting, the organisation that are putting on the air display here today on behalf of the council. TSA organise air displays around the UK. If you want to run an air show, you get in touch with them and they will organise all of the permits, put the flying programme together and so on. But now we look high above us because the next group of jumpers are about to start their element of the performance. We'll see the pyrotechnics starting to burn very shortly, I hope. That'll help us pick them out for you. When those pyros ignite, you should be able to see three canopies almost touching each other. Indeed, starting the vertical dive, the pyro about to come on. The pyro burning at the moment is not from the main group. That's from the cameraman high above the formation, and unfortunately the main group did split in the darkness, so we haven't been able to see that even with the naked eye. I could barely make that out. These air displays at night, they can be absolutely magical, and sometimes they can be a little bit frustrating. It's not something that we actually get to film very often. I used to see them all the time. I mentioned I used to do some work with one of these pyro display teams, but with Planes TV, it's just not something that tends to happen very often at the events that we've covered. We did see one last week, though, on the 27th of August, the Duxford Flying Evening. Ben Dunnell talking you through the action on that occasion, and Ian introducing it all as well. Was on camera. That was a thoroughly enjoyable day. We had some terrific warbird performances as the sun set, and then just afterwards Mark Jeffries in his extra 330 SC pyro streaming from the wingtips. That stream went out free on YouTube, one of many that have gone out free on YouTube this year. A few Duxford flying days. The old Buckingham Air Show went out for free. Obviously Bournemouth here today, the first day of the Headcorn Air Show and the arrivals and departures of the Royal International Air Tattoo. And with the Tigers safely on the ground, that concludes our flying display programme for today. Apparently Mark has bought us a dessert on the way home by means of a super chat. Thank you very much, Mark. I've actually eaten rather well today. Just been out for a curry in the gap between the two flying programmes, but I'll take your dessert, why not? And another super chat as well from, goodness, I'm not even going to have a go at pronouncing this, WHTALT92. Well, thank you very much. It's all appreciated. It encourages us to do more of this kind of thing. In fact, the feedback universally over the past couple of days has been very encouraging indeed. Well, as I mentioned, if you enjoyed it, do make sure you are subscribed to catch that broadcast from Jersey. Subscribe to the Planes TV newsletter and you'll hear how to watch the live stream from NATO days in a couple of weeks, because we don't know exactly where, when and how that is going to be shown. We're providing the cameras, adding some English commentary, but we're not responsible for distributing that stream. We'll try and let you know via a newsletter if we can. And if you have the means, then please do support us by subscribing to watch.planestv.com. That'll enable you to watch the Duxford show in a week's time. And that's not it for the year, because in October we've got another live broadcast coming up. That'll be the Duxford flying finale on October the 8th. Again, not sure exactly what service that broadcast will go out on, whether it'll be the streaming service or YouTube. So make sure that you are signed up to the newsletter so that we can let you know. But I think we'll sign off very shortly, because we've got a couple of hours journey to get home. We've got half an hour of packing up to do, and it's getting rather cold and windy up here, it must be said. I'm gonna have one final check of the chat, see what people have been saying. Hats off to the pilots, yes indeed. Not easy in the dark as well. Takes an awful lot of skill. Thank you, Adrian and Ian, for fantastic coverage today and yesterday. We've really enjoyed it. Well done again. Well, we've so much enjoyed bringing it to you. Last minute decision. Not something that we'd really intended to do. I think, is Adrian trying to get a camera on me? I don't think you're going to see anything, are you? It's too dark, but I'll stand a little bit closer. He'll get a phone light on me. No idea if you can see me or not. But it's worth a try, isn't it? Nick Horton also saying thank you. Yeah, too many messages to read out. No, but it's been a terrific few days and we're so glad that you've joined us. As I said, subscribe, visit watch.planestv.com, sign up for the newsletter, and make sure that you've got notifications turned on so that you know when we go live for Jersey. I think at this point we shall leave you with a shot of the beach out behind us for a couple more minutes, and then we'll end the stream and start packing up. Thank you very much again, and from Adrian, who's been manning the camera, me, Adam, doing some impromptu commentary in lieu of being connected to the real PA system. Thank you once again for joining us, and goodbye from Bournemouth.